In Los Angeles, I'm Kai Rizdal. It is Wednesday today.
You pay attention. With so much at stake.
Seas are rising and chronic flooding will be the new normal.
You navigate, you listen, you keep an ear out. You pay attention, and so do we. We tell the stories of our time every day.
In the 26th day of testimony, and on the 139th witness, Shahar Tsarnaev wept.
We unearth what would otherwise stay hidden.
There's just a lot of hate in this world, and that day, for that hour, we were humans.
Across the street.
The Red Sox have won the World Series.
And around the globe.
It's here and now.
This is modern love.
This is WBUR's All Things Considered.
This is only a game.
This is On Point.
This is Radio Boston.
On air, online, on demand, and on stage in the heart of Boston.
I'm Jack Lepiars. Welcome to WBUR City Space.
Always looking forward, paying attention, and knowing that your story is one of our stories.
Good morning. I'm Bob Oates.
I'm Lisa Mullins.
I'm Meghna Chakrabarti.
I'm Jeremy Hobson.
This is 90.9 WBUR Boston.
Come back. Look at our website, wbur.org/events or City Space. We are programming on average 5 events a week. I like to call it the 92nd Street Y of Boston. We're doing live podcasts. We're doing policy discussions with Governor Baker. We're doing a dance performance. We've done a coffee house opera here. We've done the Moth Story Slams, or the second Wednesday of every month. The first Monday of every month, we're having a curated cuisine with chefs in Boston. The first Tuesday of every month, we feel free to sit in the reserved seats, which were for Meghna Chakrabarti's children, but they've chosen not to be in the And we have an environmental series that we're doing with Harvard Business School. So there's something for everyone there. It's really such an array of content. And I, along with Meghna, have been aware of Blue Heron for years, and one of the first things I thought of when this place was built was to have them perform and be in conversation with Meghna. So, welcome. Q&A. If you go to your phones, we have two different ways of doing Q&A at the end of the program. We have a mic over there if you'd like to line up for a mic. We also have this program called Slido. If you go to your phone, put slido.com, it will come up and you'll see a password, and the password tonight is BH423. BH is in Blue Heron, and you can just type in your questions, and then when we're ready, we'll put the questions on the screen. But if you'd rather not do that and line up, if you do a Q&A, that's fine as well.
I was wondering if, before we dive into conversation, if you would start with a brief performance to give us a,
sure,
just a feel for what we're going to be discussing. Okay.
Do you want to know what it is?
Yes.
Because it's not too brief. It's the first piece from the Remede de Fortune, which is a lay in praise of the perfect lady with whom our lover is smitten and can't tell her. And Jason incarnates the lover, and then Martin, and then Owen in sequence. It's a quite long poem, of which we're only doing an excerpt.
Okay, great.
Confort vouloir rôder car pour y
sire in a fashion mad a taille y plaigne l'amour d'art qui souvent de stock et d'étaille seulement mon cœur d'étaille serve bien en l'aise travail car tout varie son doux regard qui t'aide amoureuse vitale mon carré dans l'intérieur sa biaute fine par l'art quand
absolutely mesmerizing. Thank you so much. Before we go any further, I wanted them to perform first so that we could really immerse ourselves in the experience that this music is supposed to take us on. So thank you for doing that. But now, without further ado, I actually should just, can you all just introduce yourselves? So, I mean, Scott, I know, but go ahead and introduce yourselves, everyone.
I'm Scott Metcalf from Blue Heron.
My name is Deborah Nagy.
Charles Weaver.
I'm Owen McIntosh. Martin Neer.
Jason McStoots.
Okay, terrific. So, first and foremost, I gather that there's a story going on here. What is this story?
The story, it's told by Machaut, Guillaume de Machaut, who's a poet and a musician, poet and a composer. And it's a story about a young man, quite young, too young to understand anything about life or love. And he's fallen in love with the perfect woman. And she's perfect in every way. She's beautiful. She's wise. She speaks clearly. And she has great judgment. And she's everything perfect. And he learns a lot from her. But he cannot reveal to her that he's in love with her. He doesn't know how to. And there's probably a social difference. Not clear. And because of this, he suffers greatly, which impels him, among other things, to write poetry and music, as is traditional. And so he goes out and he writes this long poem, of which we've just done two-thirds, a lay in praise of his lady. And you see, this is the music and the text here from one of the manuscripts. And then she the lay comes into her possession or into her presence, and she has him read it, and he can hardly stand to do it, but he does. And then she says, "Oh, who wrote this poem?" And he's so abashed he can't do anything, so he just runs out of the room without saying anything. And he falls into this terrible state, and he's eventually rescued by Hope, who is a miraculous figure who descends to him and glows faintly. And Hope says, "What's the matter, young man?" And anyway, so she offers him all this consolation, and she goes on and on and on and on. And it's instruction in how to live ethically in a world that is not designed for your satisfaction. Or
timeless
even
lesson.
Pleasure, yeah, or anything. So you're not going to get happiness from the world, certainly not from fortune, which will raise you up at one moment and then dump you off the wheel at the next. And so how can you then be happy in the face of adversity? And he learns some things in the course of the poem.
Better than nothing. So what were Machaut's years?
He was born around 1300, and he died in 1374. So he lived through the Black Death, among other things, during which time half of the population of Europe or so died.
Yeah. And was composing and poetry his vocation?
It was clearly his vocation. It's probably not the only way he made a living. For many years, he made a living as the secretary to the king of Bohemia. And then after that king died, or actually was killed in battle, he had various other patrons through the latter part of his life, for whom he wrote poems of one kind or another, and music as well.
I guess what I'm wondering is, if you could help put this piece in the context of the time, because it's clearly about love and life and transformation of some kind. It's not conventionally religiously devotional, though.
No, not at all. And one of the interesting things about this poem is that its entire ethical world, it's not that it exists in opposition to Christianity in any way, but it's that it's a sort of parallel. They go to Mass, of course, in the course of the story, and there's no question about the truth of Christianity for everyone that's participating in the story, but the ethical teaching is sort of side by side.
And so, but how common was that kind of music in the period?
The music, Machaut is the master of it. You know, he is the greatest composer of the 14th century, clearly, and possibly the greatest poet of the 14th century, I read literary scholars to say, as well. And he left us 6 volumes of his collected works, which are largely words, but also contain a lot of music.
I mean, Deborah and the rest of you, please feel free to jump in here. But so when you first encountered this piece from Machaut, what did you think of it?
I mean, it is a kind of mid-career for Machaut as well. So it's perhaps the work of a mature but not older person. I mean, if you consider that Machaut lived into his 70s, and it's a very, long and also prolific career. To pick up on what you were just saying in terms of, the relationship to, the church, really wholly secular nature of this. The music as well as the kind of theme is very much in keeping with what is going on in the 14th century, especially in France or around the French court, which is a great intellectual moment, great moment of experimentation, great moment of secularization as well. So it's both of its time and very forward-looking, which is, I think, also in keeping with, Machaut's work in general.
As we talk, they're going to actually perform three or four or five,
five
maybe?
Or something.
Smaller parts of this work. So I actually think this is a great time for another one. Would you like to?
Sure. So we'll do something really different. The first one is actually just one line of music, which we have devised an accompaniment for, but it's just monophonic. Actually, Machaut wrote a lot of music that was just one tune, and he's, as you hear, amazingly skilled at writing expressive and hypnotic melodies. But this is a polyphonic piece, so this is one that exists both in two parts with just two voices and in a four-voice version. So it's a ballade, which is a three-strophe form, three complete strophes. So we're going to do the first strophe with two voices, mm-hmm. and then the other two with the four. And there's only one person singing words. The other three parts don't have words at all, and they'll just vocalize, which they may have done in the 14th century.
D.
Oh,
does it feel like to be able to sing like that? No, it sounds amazing. Tell me a little bit, just as artists, as singers, when you're engaging with this music, I mean, what's challenging about it? What's glorious about it? Because clearly, as I watch you sing, it seems like it's an all-encompassing experience, even making this music.
Extremely challenging music. Mm-hmm. The language is challenging, the rhythm's challenging, and it's music that I think was meant to challenge. It was music made by composers to be made by musicians for musicians. So the challenge is a wonderful undertaking, and once you get it, it's very satisfying. Now it's also a very physical act, and
Take on different roles. Obviously, we just sang E for 10 minutes or whatever you just sat through. And which might seem simple, but is actually incredibly challenging to sustain one pure vowel for a long period of time, to be able to take breaths and release tension as you would need to, whereas when you're saying words, you get to move around and sort of release that. And then we all take turns in the actual concert performance singing extended songs with tons of words. And I think one of the things that's challenging for us is getting inside the words in a harmonic language that feels a little distant from our modern, you know, sound of today.
Yeah. I think something that's really interesting and wonderful, you know, as listeners as well as musicians, it's plain to see how expressive this music is, and yet it operates with a completely different set of kind of harmonic rules than, say, Mozart, you know, or even Bach. So there's a whole palette of expression, and there's a different language and a new way into understanding and bringing that expression to the fore.
How would you describe what those different harmonic rules are?
Well, one thing that I always find really interesting about this music, to look at it on the page, is actually extraordinarily simple in a way. And it's mostly made up of what we call perfect intervals,
octaves and fifths. And where the music of Mozart or Bach is made up of what we call a triad, a three-note chord that sounds sweet, and that is part of the musical language that we hear all the time. I think what's fascinating in this music is that those things that are so considered sweet and easy on the ears in later music are actually the source of dissonance, and dissonance is the source of expression in music in a sound world that is, for the vast majority, perfect fifths and octaves. So we derive expression from dissonance, and what is dissonant in this music is considered consonant in common practice. So we don't have to talk about it specifically, but we hear and understand it in that way.
Yeah, like a major triad is a dissonance in this period. Yeah. So something that would sound sweet and stable to us is in fact meant to drive somewhere.
And we're talking several centuries before, as you mentioned, Mozart. Was there a
point in time between the two when we had that the shift?
It's a gradual shift.
A gradual.
It's probably beginning already in the later part of the 14th century, but clearly in the first part of the 15th century, it's beginning to happen. That thirds are beginning to sound stable, but they don't become a third above the tonic doesn't become part of a final chord until the 16th century, really, because it's not completely finished. So final chords in Achigam, for example, very rarely have thirds. They'll just have a fifth and an octave. And then it's in the 16th century they become consonant. And then by the time we get to the 17th century, then we're in a really harmonic language that resembles more what Deborah's referred to as common practice.
Yeah.
So lasts up through into the 19th century, and then it falls apart.
And
falls apart. Gets changed.
It's part of the world of popular music as well.
Yes, that's right.
Harmonic language.
Yeah.
So I hope this question doesn't sound too gauche, but is it the development or the sort of evolution that you're talking about of a harmonic language right now? Is that because musical techniques got better, or here it's largely vocal, but or worse. Because I'm thinking sort of the analog in visual arts, in painting, for example, is technique got better. For example, or perspective,
changes,
or things.
Yeah.
There were changes that you could see in terms of approach. And I just wonder: is it similar, or is it stylistic? That's the difference. Is stylistic?
I think it's stylistic. Okay. I don't think things don't really get better.
Right.
They just change.
As people who are spending our lives in early music, it's for us dangerous and not very useful conversation to have in a way to think about music and evolution.
Right.
Evolutionary terms, yeah. Which just, you know, assumes that that which happened yesterday is more advanced than that which happened 500 years ago. They just operate with different sort of aesthetic values and different understandings.
But we get that all the time. I mean, a very, very blinkered view of musical progress, so as if what we do all with our most of our lives is not really sort of pre-expressive, you know. And there weren't really human emotions before Beethoven. It was preposterous.
Yeah.
When you state it that baldly, but that is the implicit assumption behind a lot of the way I think people approach earlier music, as if those people are so distant from us and they don't have the same feelings and they couldn't write music that was the same sort of expression.
I mean, that seems completely wrong-headed when you think, is it fair to consider that music was much more central to how people express themselves, express stories, express values in earlier centuries? Was it?
I don't know. I don't know enough to answer that.
Okay.
One way I like to look at the evolution of music itself. That's one thing. The architecture of sound is one thing, but also the understanding of the power of rhetoric of sound is a whole nother evolution that also grew. And so therefore, like, this music can be hard to understand rhetorically. Like, what are they saying musically? Mm-hmm. Whereas later stuff, it's very obviously directed as to say, it's saying this and you get it, right? And that language of rhetoric evolves. And the peak of it today is soundtrack music, or your midday soap opera backtrack. That is musical rhetoric boiled to its basic fundamentals, and it's very sort of cheap and manipulative, right? But the rhetoric evolved along with music, and the rhetoric changed and became more and more specific. And therefore, the music isn't less or more value, but it has a definite like specificity to it that gets sharper as it goes.
Different
forward.
Goals.
Different goals.
Yeah. I actually think architecture is probably a better.
Mm.
Comparison.
Yeah.
I mean, do you think that St. Peter's Basilica is better than Notre Dame? I think they're both amazingly beautiful constructions that operate on completely opposite aesthetic principles.
Well, how about another piece?
So what we have now is actually some dances. And this is from a point in the story where there's a dance, they have a dance. And there are musicians playing every instrument you can imagine, so we only brought a few with us. But these are actually not really by Machaut, or Machaut didn't write instrumental music as such, and he didn't write dance music, but what Deborah's done is taken Machaut tunes and turned them into a pair of dances, one monophonic and one polyphonic, with drums.
As much as you'd like about how you arranged this piece.
Well, as Scott said, not only did Machaut not really write any instrumental music per se, but there's very little surviving written down music that we know is for instruments. There is a little bit. Partly we understand that instrumentalists did an awful lot of improvising. And they probably had a whole repertoire of pieces that they knew by memory. Yes, there is also probably some literacy issues there.
And singers did.
Yeah.
Well, they were usually church educated.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, but in terms of instrumental music, we do have some surviving dances, so we know what the forms of those dances are. And one very common form is of dance music is called an estampie. And the way that an estampie works is that there's a, you know, a strain of music, a little melody, bit of melody, and then there is a little cadence formula. And this maybe is unresolved, so it requires some completion, and so we call that an open ending. And then maybe you can take the same cadence formula and then give it a closed ending, so it is resolved. And the way these estampies work is that you have a strain of music, and then you have an open ending, and then you do the strain of music again, and you play that closed ending. And then you might have a new melody with your open ending and your closed ending, and a new melody with open ending and closed ending. So what I've done, actually, is take, as Scott said, snippets of Machaut. There are other song forms, for instance, that in and of themselves contain an open and a closed ending. And I borrow those, and then I write new music in between, the new kind of puncti or new kind of little sentences that go in between. And in the case of the second piece, it is the melody that you heard me play on the recorder at the opening by myself is by Machaut. It's a virelay, which Machaut himself calls a kind of song for dancing. It exists in just one line of music. And so then in hopefully approximate, you know, 14... Sorry, not 14, approximate 1340s, 50s style. I've composed the other two parts that go with that. So the way that music was composed then is actually perhaps starting with a melody, perhaps starting with a tenor, usually a simpler voice of which then you get a melody written above. But I've taken Machaut's tune and made it the top voice that you hear me play. Scott was playing the second voice that was written, and which we would call the tenor. It's the most sustained, held voice, tenir. And the voice that Charlie is playing is what we would call a contratenor, a voice written against the tenor. And then intentionally, that's probably the leapiest. It's the part that jumps around the most. And it is also, I'm intending for it to we always think about counterpoint as something that's going on kind of harmonically and something that's, but I think that they also thought about rhythm as being contrapuntal. So in a way, Charlie's voice is the most active, and it's kind of filling in any, you know, rhythmic blanks and serving to make the music feel a bit more dynamic.
Yeah. So, recorder.
Recorder.
And
This is a medieval fiddle. Well, it's actually made in Rhode Island, but it's it's a copy of, well, we don't have any surviving instruments, so this is based on pictures. This was made by Carl Dennis in Warren, Rhode Island. Five-string instrument, it's strung in plain gut, and it's tuned in fourths and fifths, and it's got a couple of heron heads carved up here in the back. And this is an even more local product. This was made in Cambridge by David Hawthorne, who is an extraordinarily fine bow maker, and every now and again consents to do things like copy from a picture for a 14th century or 15th century bow out of, this is European pear wood, actually. Very simple, but it's a fantastic bow. He makes bows for BSO players. So this is quite kind of a luxury. No one had a bow this good in the 14th century, I'm sure.
As a side note, our arts reporter, Andrew Shea, did a story about him, actually, because his craftsmanship is so exquisite.
It's amazing.
That's a beautiful instrument.
It is a beautiful instrument, yeah. So.
And there?
This is a lute.
A lute?
So this is a very early form of the lute. By the 16th century, when music got third-ish, what we were speaking about earlier, the lute became the most important instrument in Europe for about 150 years. But in the 14th century, it was sort of an interloper newcomer to the scene. The harp was really the instrument of courtly accompaniment. And the lute originated in the Middle East, where it's still played today, and it's called the oud. It's really the same instrument, and there was some sort of cultural exchange that happened in roughly the century or so before Machaut, in which the lute came to Europe, and it's basically sort of like a guitar in terms of its technical construction. The frets are made of gut, which are, you know, they're just tied on. And frets were probably a very recent addition to the instrument in Machaut's time.
Interesting. And how many strings does it have?
Nine. But they're arranged in pairs. Wow. So.
And he's playing
out of a crow quill, right?
I'm using a plastic
just for
it's
tonight.
It's better on a crow.
And we'd had two drums down there?
Yes.
Yeah,
tambourine drums, okay. And then you had you have the harps,
right?
Well.
Yeah, we have a pair. We're actually never playing them together in this concert, but we each have one. And they're both by Lynn Lewandowski from Bellows Falls, Vermont. Mine's made of Vermont cherry, because I'm a Vermonter. They made it for me. But they're strung also in plain gut, and they're just diatonic, so just the white notes of the piano plus B flat thrown in. And they have this feature of these little wedges here on the pins down at the bottom of the string, which cause the string to buzz. So they don't really sound like the angelic harp of the 19th century, but this is what angels actually played. You can see it in pictures.
Yes, there is illuminated evidence, actually. And we'll talk about the imagery that we've been seeing behind us as well in a minute. But how about another piece?
Sure. What's next? We could do the Kyrie. So in the course of the story, the lover and the lady finally is able to reveal to her. And she says, well, that's wonderful. Let's exchange rings. And she's pleased by the news. You'll have to hear the whole story is coming up. We're going to do it on Friday and Saturday on our series in Cambridge. And then you get the whole story. But then they go off. They've been dancing. And then they go to mass before dinner. So, or no, it's dinner after the mass. Mass after the dinner.
It's the usual.
Yeah, I can't remember. Yeah. So this is as a stand-in for... Machaut wrote almost entirely secular music, but he also wrote the first complete polyphonic setting of the Mass Ordinary by a named composer, anyway. And this is just the first Kyrie from that. It's just a one-minute little snippet of... But you'll hear it sounds very different from his other music. Of course, the major third is a dissonant interval, but he is very fond of more pungent dissonances as well, including there's augmented octaves in that, and it's quite complicated. There's a very high tolerance for, I would say they relish dissonance in the 14th century in a way that becomes purified or expunged in a little bit later styles.
But is that, let me rephrase, what is it about this music that feels so timeless? Because obviously 14th century music is not my area of expertise at all, no way, shape, or form, but I've been to a number of Blue Heron concerts and I adore it. I mean, I feel like it produces this emotional reaction, even though sort of the academic aspect of the music, I don't understand the words, since it's like medieval French, I don't understand. But what is it? There's something seemingly funny, very fundamental that reaches people across the centuries.
So I would say that music from any period is equally powerful emotionally and expressively, potentially. And I mean, honestly, we don't know much. Do you know much technically about 19th century music?
I don't know much technically about any music, to be honest.
You know, we sort of have this idea that 19th century music is kind of normative for us, but I mean, the 19th century, that's a very odd period from our standpoint, but it doesn't look anything like what we are like either. So I think, but what is constant is that music sung by real human beings mm-hmm. in the room with mm-hmm. you, that is always powerful. And sung music is the best of all, because that singers have the best possible instrument, but also that every individual singer has an instrument which is unique. I mean, like, we can have two harps, they're pretty much, they don't sound exactly the same, but they're more or less the same. Two violins, of course, they're different, but they're violins. But singers, actually, we have a Jason and a Martin and an Owen and a Charlie. You know, they don't get voices, and it's true with any two human beings. So it's the most individual expression that we have. And I think what's great about this stuff is, in particular, is that there's no hierarchy whatsoever. I mean, the parts, they each have different functions, but they don't, none is subordinate to another part in their expression. I mean, there are technical ways in which they function differently, but so it's incredibly democratic or consensual
egalitarian.
It's egalitarian, yeah. It's perfectly, which is not how we might think of the past in Europe. In a lot of ways, that doesn't represent our past. But music's is beyond all of that, or doesn't refer to all of that. When we're singing it for you now.
Right.
Mm-hmm. I think one of the things that you're getting at too about this music, though, is partly also about Blue Heron. We've all been to medieval and Renaissance music concerts that were dry and boring. And I think that some of it has to do with the way that we as a group are really trying to approach the music as living music, as dramatic as anything made today, as about common things that people, things like love and despair and joy, you know, we're trying to bring those sort of elements into the performance of this music. And doing it live is even stronger, even better.
Yeah. How many of you have been to a Blue Heron concert before? Of course. Wow. Great, good.
Thank you.
Your Christmas concerts are the best. How many of you are actually singers? Or fantastic. Wonderful. People always ask me if I sing, and I could not carry a note to save my life, but I am appreciative of your art form. So since we're talking about sort of how this music speaks to us today, I actually would love to hear from you about how you fell in love with this music to begin with. What brought you to it?
Well, let's let Martin answer that question, because he hasn't said anything yet.
I feel that, I mean, medieval music is aside. No, I fell in love with early music when I was about seven. This stuff has just appealed to me in a very fundamental, personal way for almost my entire life. I was raised in a household where there was, you know, music playing, and Bach was my favorite composer at two and things like that. But,
he's not the norm.
but even as I started performing it, also as a young person, we performed music over the centuries, and it was this music, it was this music in the 15th century and 16th century it's absolutely my favorite. And I'm a composer as well, so new music is also really where my head is. And
practically born into it.
Yes, practically.
We all have, in this group though, we all have very different routes into it. I mean, yeah. Scott sort of comes from a family of early music folks.
My parents were involved doing stuff in the 60s, but already, so I grew up hearing it, but not at age two that I recall.
Not at age two.
So my parents were in the University of Vermont Baroque Ensemble. And so in the 60s, when it was hippie culture, not my parents are not hippies at all, but there were hippies around us. They arrived on the later side. But so it's sort of the counterculture. But I grew up hearing LPs, you know, from Europe, because my dad had a large record collection. And I was a violinist at the time, but I really leaned to the early stuff. And then have just gone earlier and earlier and earlier. You know, I like Baroque violin, and then I got really into 17th century music, and then I started doing 16th century music. I really love 15th century music, but 14th century music. You know.
How did you come to it?
Well, I'm trained as an oboist. I come from a completely non-musical family. You know, so I always think, not only that there's this small miracle for people who don't come from musical families ending up in music, but I'm also extremely jealous of those people who were listening to that stuff at age two. And people who do come from musical families, there's something different in their DNA. But I happened upon period instruments, and specifically Baroque oboe, really right towards the end of my undergraduate degree. And then I had this crazy opportunity one day to go sit in on a kind of playing session with some of the best sham players in the world. And the sham is the predecessor to the oboe. And I didn't really know anything about the sham. I certainly really didn't particularly know anything about 15th century music, which was really the heyday of the sham. And I was this hotshot Baroque oboe player, and into my hands was put this instrument that I had never played before, and they said, get up there, and I was looking at this page, and it looked simple enough. It was a bunch of whole notes and half notes and quarter notes and a few eighth notes thrown in, but yeah. And actually, I was just awestruck by the degree of rhythmic complexity, by the Yeah, by this, it seemed like another language in front of me, and this extraordinary opportunity, and a world just sort of opened that afternoon as I was, really discovering 15th century music through a very hands-on way. It wasn't, something that I was merely accessing through a required music history course with, I have to do these three listening assignments, and I, write my notes, and I turn the next page, and I'm done with that. It was a very visceral experience, and really life-changing in that one afternoon.
Wow. That's a fantastic story. Anyone else?
Yeah. I, growing up in rural North Carolina, I never sang any early music of any kind until I got to college. And in the same semester, first semester freshman year, I did the Victoria Omanium Mysterium, both the motet and the entire mass, and Bach Magnificat in one semester. And it was like someone took my mind out of my head and just scattered it all over the walls. Both of those things sort of planted an interest for me in both Baroque and older Renaissance and medieval music. And I pursued a sort of regular path of vocal training and music training throughout that time, but always with an interest in that. I continued to do a lot of Renaissance polyphony in undergrad, and went to graduate school, and my voice teacher's here, Sharon Daniels, and studied opera, and sang all the things I could get my hands on, and it was after I got out of graduate school that I found my way back to Renaissance music and polyphony, and have continued to get older and older. And one of the things I think is interesting is that it's all opera. I mean, you go back to Trouvère songs, it's opera. It's all people pouring their hearts out for an emotional response from someone else.
We've also all been working together for a long time, actually.
That's true.
Martin and I for almost 20 years. Deborah and I for getting on 20 years. Jason, like 15.
Yeah.
Owen 10-ish
yeah.
Now. Charlie,
he's
somewhat younger.
He's the baby.
It's been a number of years, and we have worked in different situations. I mean, all of us. So we have a lot of hours together in that rehearsal.
And he could tell you a lot more. But one of my proudest Boston early music scene moments was dragging this guy, Owen McIntosh, out of a practice room over at NEC. Yeah. To audition for Scott and for other people. That's the real deal. Let's get that. That was my second year of graduate school, and I didn't want to do the operas that they were doing in the program that I was in. Mm-hmm. So I just finished my degree, and this guy was like, "You should audition for this group. This is a good story. You should audition for this group he was directing." And I was like, "Okay, what should I sing?" "You sing some Bach." I was like, "Anything? Yes, anything." And I'd never done any early music. And this is Exultamus. Anybody knows Exultamus? And so I go and have my audition, and I never sung any early music. I was on track to be an opera singer. And I get an email saying, like, "Just FYI, we're at 4:15, blah, 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 blah." And I replied and said, "I thought my audition was at 2:30.
That's an early music joke right there.
I was like, "What's this 4:15? And then... I ended up getting the work, and then working a bunch with this guy, and then people wanted to hire me, and so then I just kind of got pulled into this world, and it's very satisfying. It's music I could do, and it was one to like sharpen your musicianship skills on, and it's just been kind of just swept me away.
But a lot of us as singers in Blue Heron have a lot of opera experience, a lot of stage training. As among early music groups, I think we are quite rare for that reality, in fact.
You're the last one.
When I was 19, I saw Monteverdi's Orfeo in college, and like that night, I was like, I'm going to do that the rest of my life. And as far as medieval music, when I live in New York. When I moved to New York, I happened to get hired in a church that sings chant every Sunday, and sort of fell into that, and I've been doing it every week for 15 years now. So sort of medieval cycle of music on which much of this music is based. The part I just sang in the mass movement is a chant that I know really well, and the tenor of the last piece we're going to play today is a chant I know really well and sang a few times last week during Holy Week. And so I have that other sort of angle on it.
Yeah. Well, before we get to the last piece, though, there's another motet that you wanted to do,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah, and that's the one you're thinking of, right? That's got this tenor. If we do a motet.
Okay, but oh. The last one is the valedictory, though, is that right?
Yes, that's
okay.
Last.
But we're going to do the penultimate one. All right, great.
They're both motets.
So this first one is a motet. It's a secular motet with a sacred tenor. It's not at all, it's not likely that the tenor was not sung to words. It's stretched out enormously and sort of chopped up. It's a kind of a mechanical foundation for the rest of it. Deborah's going to play that in Dusen, so you actually get to hear her play this medieval double reed instrument. That's half its range right there. You just heard half the notes it can do. But they're so, everyone is gorgeous, and the other five are also really beautiful. And then there are the two top parts, which are almost in the same range, sing different texts. And these are about fortune. One of them says, if you trust in the promises of fortune, that's not a good idea. And the other one says, your fortune is treating me really badly. I'm out to sea in a boat that's got a hole in it, and it's rotten, and it's sinking, and there's no anchor, and no rudder. And they go on simultaneously. I don't think you can understand the words, but you will have the text here. And then the tenor would say, it's a little bit of a Holy Week text that says, obedient unto death. Tenor text, it says that there's no one who can help.
Oh, okay.
Is there no one who can help as they're out to sea like this?
That seems like quite a trip to do all that at the same time.
It's a lot of compartmentalization.
So before we play, you play the last piece, I just want to know that after they do that, if for anyone who has any questions, please, by all means, head up to the microphone, or if you've been using the app, that's terrific too. But we should talk about the illustrations, the illuminations that we've been seeing.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the ones that you mentioned at the very, very beginning. Are they from the works that Machaut had?
Yeah,
made?
And I should acknowledge the person who designed all our projections. It's Sean Keener, who's at the back of the room. Mm-hmm. We are all doing at least two things up here, but she's also a musicologist who also has this tech side and does editing and visual stuff. She's amazing. The Machaut curated these six surviving complete works anthologies, and some of them are quite lavishly illuminated as well, especially the first one. So the pictures that you've been seeing are from those manuscripts, and the really sumptuous ones, like including this one, which is, this is the close-up of Fortune, who is of course blind, and cranking a wheel, which is not even connected to the wheel you're on. She's so far, she couldn't care less about you, she's so far away, she's gears away from human life. These are all from this manuscript, which is from the late 1340s-ish. Yeah. But there are other ones from the course of his life, and you'll see some of those if you come to the complete show Friday and Saturday. Sean's mixed in various ones. They show, there's a picture of, I think, for each one of the songs, and there are pictures at different points in the story. Yeah. You get the picture, you get the banquet, you get the dance, you get the guy,
the park
where he's writing his complaint at length about Fortune.
Yeah, it's interesting to just think about this work, the Remede de Fortune, as an original sort of multimedia piece, because at the way that it appears in the manuscript is in a way very much the way that we've presented in the projections. There's a lot of pure poetry, which we've distilled into a sort of narrative text script that Jason reads in between the pieces. There is the music that is interpolated, you know, directly into this incredibly long lyric poem, and there's also this visual element, you know, this kind of description, you know, literal illumination of what is going on in the course of the narrative.
There's a full opening
of this manuscript, and this thing that you've been seeing, you know, across this entire screen is just built into the course of the text. So we are just hoping to bring to life what is making a kind of 3D experience out of this work of art, which is in and of itself a multimedia piece.
It's gorgeous.
Yeah, it's really beautiful. The colors are fantastic.
It's also a gift.
I think it's not entirely clear what they're commissions. I mean, clearly Machaut didn't pay for it to give it to a noble. The noble would have paid for it on some sort of commission. Mm-hmm. Or it might have been a gift from a commissioner to another noble, wealthy person.
And it's also worth mentioning by the, you know, grace of technology, anyone can look at this manuscript and related manuscripts online through the Bibliothèque Nationale de France, the French National Library website.
So they scanned them all?
Yeah, okay. Yeah. It's incredible.
Wow.
That's where these are all from, their scans.
Well, would you like to...
Yeah.
To close with this valedictory?
Sure. So this is the last piece on the concert. It's actually not from the Remede de Fortune, but it's a motet which may have been a kind of valedictory for his favorite patron who died of the bubonic plague, probably. And again, there are three texts going on. So Jason sings the tenor, which is the lowest part, and he says over and over and over again, I'm not at all certain of having a lover, but I am a loyal friend. Mm-hmm. And then Martin and Owen sing the praises of the lady in different words above that. And then we're doubling them. So it's actually a three-voice piece that we're doubling with instruments. Hold on. This one I actually do need.
Loud is his crying, he is
of
Open the floor to questions. There's one question. Scott and I talked before the show that there's a question that he suggested that I ask, and I'm going to ask it. I'm going to give my answer to your question before I ask it. My answer to your question is joy. You give us joy. But here's what Scott wanted me to ask. He wanted me to ask, what is the purpose of doing this music today? Does it make sense to be doing this kind of music at this moment?
Yeah, I was thinking actually more about does it make, what purpose is the arts serving in the world at the moment? You know, I think that I feel pretty helpless at the moment and at odds with a lot of what's going on in the world. And I feel in the arts, we have so little power. And one of the answers, I think, is that, well, none of us actually has much power at all. We have a little teeny bit of individual power. I think that is one answer. I mean, another thing that I find in the context of this group and this group of people that I'm so lucky to work with all the time is that in musical ensemble work, chamber ensemble work is a kind of lab for living together in a respectful and cooperative way, in which everyone brings their opinions and their voice, and we try to listen to everybody and put it together into a whole that is better than what any one of us would have come up with alone. Mm-hmm. So it's a kind of social practice. It's kind of a practice of civilization to work together. If we do it in a way that we aspire to, with intense respect and love for each other, and listening to the fact that we don't agree. Because we never agree. I mean, no two of us ever feels the same way about any note. No, and but that's great.
Yeah.
But it means that in rehearsal, you know, we have to, if we allow the time for those disagreements to flourish, first of all, you need a lot of time because you actually have to deal with it. But you know, we constantly have to practice people saying to us, yeah, but that thing you're doing, that actually it's not that great, and try this. But I thought I was doing a good job, but that's not the point. The point is we could all be doing a better job and we can all learn from each other.
Yeah. Well, I keep looking at this picture up here of, as you said, Fortune. She's blindfolded, she's cranking away, she doesn't really care, but she has favored us tonight with this with this performance. So
not gonna laugh.
But I
read
just,
the book.
I just wanted to thank you all once again. Thank you so much. Good job, everyone. We've got some questions here from Anonymous. With your care for authentic performance, how do you choose or decide about vocal and, da gamba vibrato? Did I say that right?
On a bowed string instrument as well. This is not a hard question, actually. Vibrato is something that is documented to have existed for as long as people have been singing in the European tradition. It's used differently in different centuries, but sort of a vibrato that emerges from support and spin and using your body is something I speak as a violinist, so it emerges from good technique and good use of your body. And then you learn how to use it and apply it stylistically in a way that makes the music work. So we know they did it, and it's clear that the kind of vibrato that you might hear in modern opera performances doesn't work in, I was going to say any kind of music, but it definitely doesn't work in this music because it obscures tuning, it obscures linear progress. But, you know, we use it. So the answer is we almost never talk about it, actually. Just like anything is okay, and let's figure out what works musically. It's a little bit different on instruments because it's not, you can add it or not, it doesn't, and mostly it doesn't work on instruments, actually. That was true into the 20th century. It's really, it's a product of the musical evolution between the world wars that constant vibrato becomes a feature of string playing. And it's later, maybe you listen to clarinets now. They don't play with vibrato. French horns don't play with vibrato. There's sort of these pockets left. So it's, you know, it's just an element in our toolkit like any other element.
Well, since you mentioned evolution, you see Douglas's question there about that there wasn't really any evolution, but Douglas is wondering who was Machaut's audience and what did it bring to the listening?
That's a very difficult question to answer. I mean, Machaut, the people paying his bills were nobles, royalty, and other nobility. He also worked for the church. He was a canon in the cathedral at Reims for many years, and that's where he ended up his career. But who is listening to this music?
I think there are also intellectual circles.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I talked about this increasing secularism in the 14th century, and that is also related to intellectualism and appreciation of art for art's sake, and what is secular music except art for art's sake, in a kind of fundamental way, in a way that, you know, creating art for the glorification of God is something else, if that makes sense. So I lost my train of thought, but to answer who is listening to some of this music, it may be a noble audience. It may also be an audience of his peers. And when I say his peers,
highly educated.
There's
no question that art of this kind in the 14th century in Europe is an elite art. The marvelous thing about it is that there's absolutely no reason why that has to be true.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, they're the people who are paying for it, and it was an incredibly stratified society, even more than ours is, I think.
Avoid the plague somehow.
It's best if you leave town.
Yeah. I think also the range of work that we do have by Machaut, everything from these extraordinarily complex, you know, four-voice songs to dance songs and one voice also speaks to, you know, a wide range of styles and by extension to kind of degrees of accessibility.
Yeah.
So
are you going to release a CD of some of this music?
It seems extremely likely. You know, the future, fortune, you know, we can't predict the future with complete certainty, but we are recording the concerts this week, and the intent is to release a live CD. It'll be a few years.
A couple more really interesting questions. Are you reading from the manuscript? If not, how is what you're reading from different?
Charlie can answer that one.
Sure. We're not reading from the manuscript. We are mostly reading from editions made by Scott and Deborah that are close. I think most of us could read from the manuscript, but the handwriting is a little weird, and then we wouldn't get the parts that Deborah wrote. So
yeah, it's much harder to read the text off the manuscript than it is to
really
read the notes.
It's really more the text. More about the text than anything else.
Yeah, and there's also choices that have been made through the editing process. So, I mean, what we're playing off of
our modern editions made by Scott and I.
But we started with that.
And but we started with the original source material as a basis. And then decisions are made both, you know, by us as editors about text underlay, for instance, and then as well by the artists when it actually comes down to it. And it's among the things that get dealt with in rehearsal. So, you know, being able to, the other thing that's worth understanding, which you don't have a totally full sense of looking at the projections, is that this music does not exist in score in the original form. In fact, score music wasn't written and preserved in score, with one notable exception, until the 17th century. So, you know, there's an incredible convenience, practical convenience, to being able to look at, you know, all three or four voices in vertical alignment, which is a complete impossibility using the original sources.
So this will be the last question of the night, because I think it's a very good closing question here. What does the piece reveal as the way to overcome fate or misfortune?
Well, fortune turns out to be essentially a Zen master, and she says that if you expect things that are impossible, you will be disappointed. If you desire things that are unattainable, you will be unhappy. And if you trust in the gifts of fortune, wealth and fame, you will lose them and be crushed. And the only way to be happy, the sovereign goods of nature, are individual happiness that is completely independent of whether fortune favors you or not, and what you have. And so she says there's going to be suffering, and things are going to go wrong. But if you don't, I'm trying not to phrase this too much like a Zen master, if you don't attach, I'm not one, if you don't attach to the result, then you'll be happier. Uh-huh. Then you can be happy. And the guy almost gets it. But he's young. And that's a really hard lesson to learn.
Well, I just want to say once again, as we're having a 4-year-old meltdown back there, thank you all so very much for this evening. It's been absolutely beautiful. And every time I see Blue Heron perform, I just thank goodness that you were here and part of our community.
Thank you.
So thank you so much for tonight. Thank you all for coming as well this evening.
Thank you.
WBUR.org.